So as we get to this intersection, it's the first place we're talking about using those. As an example, here are some that are actually out near Lena that we installed a few years ago. So you can see here there's parking. You've seen this picture before, but we put the curb bulb on the side of the street with the parking. So it creates a definitive end to the parking zone, brings that pet drop from what would have been here up to here, so it's closer to the travel lane, so visibility improves. And just another view of that, you can see it here on both sides of the intersection. So, you know, when you look at the overall street width, and it's narrowed in to that. So that's that narrowing, and it's two travel lanes through in this case. And just, again, you feel a little more constricted as a driver, and when you feel that way, people tend to slow down. So in this case, and I just switched to the next block, we will look back at this intersection of Polk. There's our first curb bulb on the north side. There's parking on that side. And then on the south side, in this concept, I am transitioning essentially from one side of the street to the other side, because currently we have parking on the north, west of Polk, and we have parking on the south, east of Polk. So I wanted to maintain that. So because of that, we then transition the lane from this location up to this location where we're moving it to the north. So this curb bulb becomes a little different because it's also a guidance curb line. Right? We're taking people on one alignment and we're shifting them in their car to the north. And so we're providing essentially a curb there to help force them, if you will, further to the left to get in line with the continuing easterly lane. Now we've entered the 30-foot section, and this will be the case all the way past Blaine. This is the existing road section. In essence, this is what we have today, and unfortunately you can't see the numbers on here, but on the drawings, hopefully it's more visible. We're looking at 11-foot lanes, so we've narrowed down to 11 feet with an 8-foot park. In effect, that's what we have today. It's not marked. We haven't marked center line, we haven't marked parking, but under this proposal, we would mark that. So it's similar to what you'd see up today on 6th Street. On 6th Street, we did this very thing, 11-foot lanes, 8-foot parking. That center line is sitting way off, in that case, to the south side, because parking is generally on the north. And when you're in that lane that's 11 feet from center to curb, you feel it. And if you're in any kind of bigger vehicle, you're close to those trees, you feel it. You know you're there. And so again, it tends to help speed. With a 30-foot section, if we're going to maintain parking, this is about what we can do. There are some alternatives that we'll be looking at as we go forward, where we could consider a different section that would remove parking. There's a trade-off there, but perhaps go to, in essence, either 10-foot travel lanes, which are very narrow, plus bike lanes on either side that are 5 feet. You could go to a 10.5 and 4.5, which are narrow for bike lanes. Or you could go to something called an advisory bike lane, where you have a 15-foot lane and the outer 5 feet has a dash bike lane. The idea is that you want bikes to ride over there, but cars can use it. They just have to coexist. So those are possibilities that as we move forward, we could also look at. For the time being, with this concept to start out, just working with kind of what we have existing in terms of two lanes plus parking, with the idea of preserving parking through that stretch. Parking, again, if it's used, can act as a traffic calming, because, again, if you're near a car, you're seeing those mirrors go by, and you got a center line that's close on the other side, you tend to slow down. I will say, of course, in this corridor, as most people know, it's not heavily used for parking until you get East Hayes on a day-to-day basis. And then certainly during events at East City Park, it's well used. But outside of that, which is the rest of the year, it's a pretty lightly used area. So other alternatives might be worth considering. Okay, continuing on, we kind of skip a block in terms of curb bulb, but I pick them up again off the road. Part of that is, trying to manage overall budget. I have to be cautious about how much I propose spending. And then the question becomes, do you need curb bulbs at every single intersection, or is the message conveyed if you're hitting maybe every other intersection? They're not terribly long blocks, so as I've laid it out here, I'm kind of skipping one. and trying to hit the ones where I really anticipate seeing higher pedestrian usage. So obviously, we're approaching Monroe. This is the southwest corner of East City Park. High pedestrian zone at certain times of the year. So again, looking to put in curb holes here on the south side where the parking exists. So this 30-foot section probably is going to drop down to maybe 23 or 4. You don't typically take the curb line right to the edge of the 11-foot travel lane. You have to have a little setback for the curb just so you don't hit it. So instead of 22, which is the two lanes, it might be 23 or 24. We have to figure that out in the design. But that does feel narrow. And again, you'll see here in the plan where we've shown those little squares represent where the ADA drops would be. That would bring that pedestrian further out for visibility as compared to the travel lane. So that section continues. This is East City Park. Lincoln Street, nothing at Lincoln because it's a T at the moment in this plan. And then that brings us to the intersection of Hayes, which is a very busy area. At Hayes, suggesting the first, what I call a double bulb out. And by that it means that it extends into both streets of the intersection. So we extend the curb line to the north as part of 3rd, but also extend it to the east as part of Hayes. We can do that on Hayes because there's parking along this west side, as there is parking on the east side. So we still maintain 2 travel lanes, but a little more narrow, and then, of course, a little more narrow here. We do have this pretty wide sweeping curve here. It's not quite this big because it's been brought in just a little bit in the project we did 2 summers ago now. It's still pretty large. I have not recommended anything there yet. I'm assuming that this big sweep was because there's a lot of right turn movement here, maybe even some of the trucks, because that's a pretty big motion movement through town from north end to downtown. So that's what you see there is a little bigger area. Potentially we could do something different there, but for the moment I'm proposing on the south side.
Can I ask
you
a question?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, okay, on this, because I'm so familiar with this area because I go there every day. And so these drawings and so forth showing the traffic flow and the bikes and the pedestrian, this does not show stop signs, right?
No. This is just the layout in the street itself.
Okay.
So at this point, I've not addressed any changes in stop signs. I mean, we have out there in this particular intersection, 3rd Street is a stop, Hayes is the through street.
That's a very dangerous intersection for cars and people.
So it's one of the intersections we'll be looking at, along with all of them, really, to consider whether some changes are necessary or warranted in that area. So, Linda Pike, address?
Mary Ann Reese. May I ask, the extended red line, is that just, does that mean anything?
Well, that's just a dimension line that shows you from there to there, it's 30 feet. That's all it is. It's just a dimension, existing.
So
width.
It's 30 feet from?
Curb to curb, 30 feet wide.
That part's 30, and so
from the arrows,
the extended area is not meant to indicate land owned by the city.
Oh, no, that's just a drawing meter to say, okay. That from this arrow to that arrow, which is curb to curb,
okay.
Is 30 feet wide.
Thanks.
Yeah, you bet. Yeah, here we're able to put the number in the middle. Sometimes you put the number to the outside. That's all it is.